Dodge is known as a brand for putting attitude first and everything else second. And we have a perfect example of that today with the new Dodge Hornet. This came out last year, but for 2024, the plug-in hybrid version is now available. That's what we have here, the Dodge Hornet RT Plus. Now with this version of the Hornet, Dodge is trying to bring the sports and performance aspect to the subcompact crossover segment. But with a ton of competition, can the new Hornet live up to its high price tag? That's what we'll find out. The Hornet has intimidating looks to go along with its cool name, and that is exacerbated by this Acapulco gold color, which really brings the exterior design to life. You can definitely tell off the bat this thing was made for performance, and it definitely shares a resemblance to the Alfa Romeo Tonale, which is kind of a sister brand to Dodge under the Stellantis umbrella. Backing up those performance credentials are a lot of functional vents around the front. These whole areas are open to allow extra airflow and feed that engine. And while these vents on the sides are actually fake, the ones on the hood are functional. From the side, you can really see that the Hornet is more of a lifted up hatchback than a traditional SUV. So think something like a Mazda CX-30 or Hyundai Kona N in terms of price and performance. You can also see some of the extra packages that have been added onto this one, things like the blacktop package to get these black mirrors and blacked out badges, and also things like the optional track pack, which comes with 20-inch wheels, Michelin all-season tires, and those fancy-looking red brake calipers. At the back, the Hornet has a pretty traditional looking hatchback vibe with a sporty sloping roofline that looks pretty cool. These big dual exhaust tips definitely indicate that there's plenty of performance hiding under the skin. And the RT and RT Plus plug-in hybrid versions come with a power liftgate. Every version of the Hornet gets a lot of turbocharged power for the class. Base GT models get a 2.0-liter turbocharged four-cylinder engine, making 268 horsepower and 295 pound-feet of torque. As for RT models like this one, you get a smaller engine. It's a 1.3-liter four-cylinder, but again, it's turbocharged and it's got that plug-in hybrid system. So combined, you're getting 288 horsepower and 383 pound-feet of torque. Those are massive numbers for a vehicle this size. Now, for a hybrid, the Hornet plug-in doesn't have the highest fuel economy ratings. The EPA rates this car at 29 mpg when you're running in hybrid mode. But remember, it's a plug-in hybrid, so you get fully electric range of 33 miles, and that is pretty impressive. When it comes to pricing, you can find Hornet GT models with the base engine in the low $30,000 range. Meanwhile, to get into the plug-in hybrid RT version, that's going to be in the low $40,000s. Then if you want one of the plus models like this one, tack on an extra $5,000. And if you throw on some of the packages we talked about earlier, this car comes to $52,000. Now, compared to those sporty competitors like the Kona N or the CX-30, that is really expensive. Let's see if it backs it up. First impressions inside the Dodge Hornet, and I'm pleasantly surprised. Sure, there is quite a bit of plastic on this center tunnel right here, but everywhere else, the materials look pretty nice, especially for Dodge, which is typically more like the budget brand. There definitely are hints of Alfa Romeo in here. I wonder how Alfa Romeo feels about that. But it works out well for the Hornet. This steering wheel feels great. I was a little concerned that it would feel too compact in here. And yeah, there are some concerns, like I'm 6 feet tall and my legs and knees just feel a little bit tight. But there's plenty of headspace and a lot of adjustability in the seat as well. Standard on every Hornet is dual zone automatic climate control. And I really like these climate control buttons right here because first of all, they're physical. They're not hidden up in the screen and they look and feel really nice. These vents also have a cool knurling to them and they just feel really nice to the touch with satisfying clicks too. What if you step up to the RT Plus model? Now this is where the Hornet can get really expensive, but it does come with some cool features. First of all, these seats are now genuine leather and Alcantara, and they're heated too. Structurally, the seats feel really nice with good cushioning. They might be a little bit wide from side to side, but these bolsters keep you in place pretty well. On top of that, there's also a 14-speaker Harman Kardon stereo and a wireless smartphone charging station up here. The Hornet comes with some really cool screens on every model standard. You get a 12.3-inch digital display in front of the driver and a 10.25-inch touchscreen in the center here. Let's dive into the screen. It's got a good size and it's running on Stellantis's latest version of its Uconnect infotainment system. This is really cool looking. In fact, I think the thing I like about it the most is that it looks really cutting edge and modern. You can add different pages and all sorts of menus and gauges to get really any type of information that you want. This one also has navigation and the maps look great. There's a 3D view, there's a 2D overhead view, and you can pinch or swipe to zoom or zoom out, just like a smartphone. It's also live traffic, which in LA comes in really handy. Now, the caveat is that while all this stuff looks really good, in practice, sometimes it's a little bit difficult to use. The screen can be slow to respond, some of the icons are pretty small, and without a dial or any way to control it, you have to be pointing up here quite a bit. There's a way we tried to get around that, and that's by using the voice controls. Now, this voice control system can perform lots of functions, everything from the climate control to changing the radio, but you have to say it in exactly the right way. So it just might take some practice, but there are cool features here. A lot of the positive qualities from the front carry into the back seat of the Hornet here. For instance, you've got these leather seats and Alcantara inserts with some cool contrasting stitching and some red underlay there. There are also soft materials up here on the door, and rear passengers get vents and USB ports, including a USB-C. So there's lots of good here. My legs are even okay space-wise, and my head isn't a problem either. So there's lots of good back here. The fact is, you're just constricted by the space of this thing. It's a subcompact, so you're just not going to have as much space as a CR-V or a RAV4. And if you're okay paying $50,000 for something of that size, that's up to you. But the money in this car is really going towards performance. Let's see how that measures up. Before we get to performance, let me show you the cargo space back here. Now, the Hornet doesn't have a ton. In its plug-in hybrid version, it's about 22.9 cubic feet of space. Now, the base models without the plug-in system actually have more space. So if that's a concern, maybe look at those. But for the plug-in version, you're in between the Mazda CX-30 on the low end, about 20 cubic feet, and the Hyundai Kona on the high end, about 25 and a half. To their credit, it does look like Dodge made this opening about as big as they could with these wide open cutouts, and look how high the power liftgate goes. I couldn't hit my head on it if I tried. Finally, we're behind the wheel of the Dodge Hornet RT Plus, and there is a lot going on here. It's a plug-in hybrid system, so of course you've got power coming from the engine, but also from the battery powering an electric motor at the rear. So you can be in a couple of different modes. You can be in full electric, you can be in hybrid, or you can be in what Dodge calls E-Save, which is gonna try to preserve the battery juice as much as possible. Right now, we're gonna go into hybrid, we're gonna switch onto sport mode, and we're gonna see what 288 horsepower feels like. This car has a lot of power, definitely. That is a lot of muscle to put in a car this size. And like we said earlier, there are not many competitors that even really come close. It's kind of just the Mazda CX-30 and the Hyundai Kona N. And those are really more well known for like responsive handling and agility than their sheer outright power. By contrast, it feels like power is the calling card of the Hornet here. As we're heading out onto an incline on this hill, I'm gonna hold back both of these massive steering wheel paddles, and that's gonna activate something called Power Shot. A little icon comes on, and that gives you an extra boost of power for 15 seconds. That's a lot of power. We're getting up to speed very, very quickly. It's fun. Hornet is a good name for this thing. So is Power Shot. Nice snarl from the engine too. Okay, that's genuinely fun. But what about other driving modes? I don't suspect anyone is really going to be taking this to a track. You're probably going to be driving to and from work. And in those situations, the Hornet has a neat trick because it has an adjustable suspension, which can get softer for smoother driving or firm up for more aggressive. For that type of everyday around town driving, I'm not so enamored with this. The steering feels a little loose and disconnected. The brakes have that kind of squishy plug-in feel. I do like that you get a strong regenerative braking feeling so that when you come off of the throttle, you're immediately met with some resistance that's giving power back to the battery. That's cool. Overall though, this feels like quite a nice car to drive. It's relatively quiet inside, and I can definitely feel the elevated riding height right now. This may be a lifted up sedan, but it does feel more like a traditional crossover or SUV view of the road. That doesn't mean visibility is perfect. This car has some blind spots that are tough to see in the mirrors. This pillar is pretty big, and the size of the ceiling and the dash makes the windshield view feel a little bit squished. But like I said, Dodge is all about attitude, and so the styling and the power comes first. All that other stuff comes second. Now I've switched us into full EV mode, so we're running only on electric power right now. One of the interesting things about that is the electric motor is mounted on the rear wheels. So when you're in EV mode, you're basically running rear wheel drive instead of all wheel drive, which is how this car normally operates. So just cruising along, this feels really nice. It's pretty quiet in here. Power delivery is smooth. Electric juice feels good on the Hornet. Step on it, that's pretty delayed. So that's not like, you know, traditional electric car feel where you step on the throttle and immediately you're met with full torque. In fact, there was quite a delay and then the car switched into hybrid mode and brought on the gas engine. So maybe that performance aspect doesn't translate to full EV mode. And that's okay. Interesting thing about this car in the plug-in version is that it has multiple personalities, kind of, and you can switch between them. So when you want the sport stuff, stick with the gas motor, put it in sport mode. When you want cruising and emissions-free driving, then you go with EV. So what are the biggest pros and cons of the new Dodge Hornet? Well, first and foremost, the biggest pro is that they nailed the attitude component, especially for something in a normally pretty sleepy subcompact crossover segment. The second positive is a much nicer interior than I was frankly expecting. And the third is the full range of personalities that this thing has on the road, from top level performance all the way to full electric driving. That's pretty impressive. What about weaknesses? Well, there are definitely more practical options in this segment from the Toyotas and Hondas of the world. And second, that plug-in hybrid system can be a little bit clunky and unrefined in its power delivery. Now, that's a tall ask when you want people to pay as much money as Dodge is asking for here. At $50,000 or even in the low $40,000, that's a lot of money for something in a class that's normally about affordability. Some of the lower optioned models in the $30,000 range might be a better bet. All in all, the Hornet brings some much needed flavor to this subcompact crossover segment. The question is, how much are you willing to spend to get it? Well, that's all for today. Thanks so much for watching, and please click like and subscribe if you enjoyed the video so we can make more of them. If you want to learn more about the Dodge Hornet or any of the competitors we mentioned in this video, click the link in the description below. And until next time, thanks for watching.